multipolaire.
This world is multipolar for more than 50% of its inhabitants in India, Africa, Latin America, in large cities, or even in China or developed countries. A large part of the economy is an informal economy, so it cannot be captured via clear indicators. According to the French Development Agency in Cameroon, 70% of all economic activity is not included in statistics. So how can we formalize modern circular economy? And how can we formalize the economy in developing countries? How can we identify economy? And how can we finance circular economy? I'm not going to talk more about the definition of circular economy. It is supposed as an integration model to integrate eco-design. But for what I am concerned, at a personal level, I'd like to tell you two anecdotes that have to do with geography and history. The first anecdote is about today's world, from Paris to Narbonne or to Béziers, through which I travel. And each time, I see how the observation of morphology, of closeness and solidarity is important to set the stage for circular economy today. I see how geographical aspects are narrowly linked to our relationships in consumption and in exchanges. I'm thinking about Julien Gracq and his essay, and he gives a magistral illustration or depiction of cities and villages. From Clermont-Ferrand to Béziers, including Lacanau, Marvejols, I'm impressed to see how, since the beginning of the 19th century, cities and villages got scattered, disconnected. Up until the 20th century, cities were getting together around the village square to be connected to one another and to share energy and warmth in an agricultural and craftsman economy. But as of the mid-20th century, solidarity disappeared, and at the beginning of the 21st century, their material and non-material solidarity has almost disappeared, whereas in the past it was totally codified and rooted in use and traditions. What is clear today is that this solidarity of many centuries is no longer seeking warmth around incinerators or collective heating plants. In our houses, we no longer share the proximity to local raw materials, coal, wood, energy, meat, vegetables. We no longer eat. We use food from supermarkets. So we can say that the connection between human beings and nature has decreased quite significantly. Since 1789, land property has had a negative impact on closeness and solidarity of people. People and people with the natural environment. And today you have people rebelling against floods in certain neighborhoods. So solidarity has decreased as the stock exchange reduced the relationship between man and nature. In France, beyond Paris and beyond Lacanau and Béziers. This disconnect has generated an existential feature for the 2008 crisis because of many conflicts that occur and that we can witness on a daily basis. In our country, the significant turning point took place with Haussmann in Paris. And this is getting even worse in those deserted areas where you have a large number of unemployed people around Béziers. The 21st century is a financial century and speculation. And it continues. With the crisis of the subprimes in 2008, it's as if the solidarity cell of villages was going to disappear, and as if all solidarities were to exist through yens and dollars. But the morality that circular economy could not exist if we were to just look at its trajectory, its momentum, and if we were not taking exact sciences into account, and given the difficulties of economic science, it could not exist if we were to disregard philosophy, geography and history. The second anecdote I'd like to tell you is about the world, is going to confront today's world and the world of yesterday with a time gap of 3 centuries. It's the history of Robinson Crusoe, which is a story written in 1719 during the Enlightenment period by Daniel Defoe. You all know about this story, and it continues with Michel Tournier, who published a novel in 1967. Tournier, who died this year, renewed Defoe's story in the light of the 21st century. He experienced this world as a world of violence and sex. And he revealed one terribly feminine character which had the ability to give pleasure to Robinson. And with this pleasure also emerged an existential anguish, a violent desire, sexual desire, that started nagging this new Robinson, whereas Friday has no such anguish because nature has always been a part of his state. In 1967, Robinson, the so-called civilized man, ended up being re-educated by this wild man, Friday, and he was ridden of his anguish. So in this 1967 novel, Robinson stays on the island and he's happy there, whereas Friday comes back to the century when the first boat comes in and starts working in competitiveness. In 1967, the fate of Vendredi is no longer the ownership of Robinson. Friday has become a citizen and belongs to himself, but we don't know what the outcome will be. But it's the second morality in the story. Friday is a citizen of the world, i.e. at the end of the day, in Defoe's actuality, in Tournier's actuality, the civilized guy lived on the earth without violating it, and the metabolism between humans and earth was reestablished. In conclusion, as Defoe was telling us about a great parable that described the conquest of the world according to the liberal Anglo-Saxon vision of the world, Vendredi by Michel Tournier raises a huge question by showing how between modern and today's history the perspective of modernity has been turned upside down. Slavery almost disappeared. Friday is now a citizen of the world, and we should wonder whether we are. To finish, what is the world we want for the future? If we were to close the world, we'd prevent circular economy to come to fruition. But in 2016, we need to make circular economy work. Everything can be sold, but nothing seems to be affordable, and the 20th century was that of banks. At least if we believe financial rating agencies, the big fours, and these are making the rules like oracles. So we still have a lot to do on the long run, but who knows? Try and think about it. Thank you.